Welcome to our live webinar titled Aplastic Anemia, What You Need to Know. Thank you for joining us. My name is Cottrell Harris, and I'm the Manager of Learning Events for the Aplastic Anemia and MDS International Foundation, and I will be moderating the presentation today. As we get started, I would like to acknowledge Alexion Pharmaceuticals, Amgen, and the Celgene Corporation for providing educational grants to support this and other webinar education programs. I would also like to share with you some additional educational opportunities you might be interested in. This year, the Aplastic Anemia and MDS International Foundation is hosting several regional conferences on living with aplastic anemia, MDS, or PNH. These free regional conferences will occur around the country and are designed to make information on bone marrow failure diseases more accessible to patients and families. We have currently had four successful conferences in Phoenix, Houston, Cleveland, and San Francisco. Registration for the remaining conferences is now open for Boston, which is September the 7th, and Tampa, which is November the 9th. Please visit our website, www.aamds.org, for more information on the conferences and all of our learning events. Today's webinar will be archived on our online learning center within 7 to 10 business days. You will be notified when it is live and ready for viewing. Immediately following the presentation, there will be a question and answer session. Please feel free to submit your questions at any time during the presentation by using the text chat window on the lower right-hand side of your screens. To submit a question or comment, type your question in the small text box just below the text chat window. When you have finished typing your question, hit enter. We will do our best to get to all questions. When asking questions, I do respectfully ask that you do two things to help us manage incoming questions. First, submit your question, your entire question, all at the same time. Do not submit it in pieces or send additional information. We do receive many questions and will not be able to piece your question together from multiple submissions. Secondly, provide the minimum amount of personal information you feel is necessary to respond to your question. Lengthy questions can be difficult to understand and to respond to. You will not be able to communicate with others during the session via the chat window. We will be the only one who can see the questions being asked. If you would like to connect with others, there's an online support form called Marrow Forms. The web address is www.marrowforms.org. You can access this site via our website. We also have a peer support network, a national network of volunteers, including patients, caregivers, and family members willing to listen and offer support. Immediately following this webinar, a post-event survey will pop up on your screens. Please take a few minutes to complete this brief survey. This will help us to improve our future webinars and make sure we are meeting your needs. As a reminder, you can submit your questions on the right-hand side of your screen at any time. Today's presenter is Dr. Amy DeZern. Dr. DeZern is an assistant professor of oncology and medicine at the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. She attended medical school at Johns Hopkins and also completed her residency, oncology, and hematology fellowships there. She also holds a master's degree in clinical investigation from the Bloomberg School of Public Health. Her primary clinical and research interests are bone marrow failure disorders, including MDS, aplastic anemia, and PNH, and other bone marrow failure syndromes. She sees clinic patients weekly with these diagnoses and has multiple abstracts and publications on these topics as well. Dr. DeZern specializes in clinical studies of diagnostics, maintains a database of samples and clinical information for outcomes research, and enjoys taking care of patients with these diseases. Currently, she is the principal investigator of a clinical trial treating patients with severe aplastic anemia using a specialized bone marrow transplant regimen at Johns Hopkins. Welcome, Dr. DeZern.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. Welcome. So we'll go ahead and get started. This is intended as a general overview of aplastic anemia, and there's some real-world experience cases in it, as well as some of the primary literature that we, as the physicians, use to try and help you, as the patients, get the best care. So just to begin with, aplastic anemia is actually the quintessential bone marrow failure disorder. I have here a picture of a bone marrow that is aplastic to contrast to the picture in the lower right-hand part that is a cellular bone marrow, what would be considered normal? And you can see it's actually very simple in the fact that there aren't enough blood-making cells there, and that's why often when people get the diagnosis of aplastic anemia, they require so many transfusions. And the medical word for all three cell lines being low is pancytopenia, all cells low. Bone marrow failure actually encompasses quite a few diseases. I use this picture in my own practice, even though it looks complicated, just to illustrate to myself and to the patients that a lot of disorders are considered bone marrow failure. But I think the real important ones, and a lot of what we're here to talk about today, are aplastic anemia, PNH, inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, and hypoplastic myelodysplastic syndrome, because sometimes these disorders can be confused for aplastic anemia, and we have to think about how they overlap and interact with each other. When you go and see a doctor, either as a consultation because you've already had the diagnosis of aplastic anemia made, or when someone is trying to make this diagnosis because they have this suspicion that that's the problem going on, there's a lot of questions that the patient and family are going to be asked, not to be overly nosy, but just really to try and get to the root cause of the low blood counts or the aplastic anemia. Certainly something that can be helpful is if you as the patient or your family knows how long you've had low blood counts. Are there records from when you were a younger child, or records even from a few years ago with a physical for an adult? These can be very helpful. A very detailed medication history is quite important, as sometimes, as you'll see in the next few slides, medications can be the cause of aplastic anemia, and we'd like to know if there's something that we could pinpoint that caused it so you never took that medication again. Sometimes infections can cause it, so knowing if you've been immunized is important, or any infectious exposures that you may have had. A transfusion history, knowing if you've ever gotten red blood cells or platelets, is very helpful, and also the frequency of which those transfusions were needed. More sometimes for children and younger adults, we take an extremely thorough family history to see if there's any family history of genetic problems or abnormalities or family histories of other bone marrow problems or cancers. Height is an easy thing to measure, but often we ask if a child is what we call mean parental height, so a reasonable average of how tall their parents are. That can be helpful. If there's any limb abnormalities in the arms or the legs, and we often look very closely at the skin or the nails, because sometimes abnormalities here can suggest something that's more syndromic than just aplastic anemia alone. There's a lot of labs, and I think sometimes patients feel frustrated, and I even feel frustrated sometimes when a patient with low blood counts needs to have so much blood taken at the time of diagnosis to make sure we get it right. But again, this is all trying to make sure we get to the right diagnosis for the patient, and so we do much testing, most of which comes from the blood and the bone marrow, to make sure we get the right answer for you. Obviously, the blood counts. A reticulocyte count is very helpful. You'll see when we get into some of the diagnostic criteria that this is one of them. And it's a number that talks about how well your bone marrow is making red blood cells in particular. And this is something you may get used to following as you see your counts over your course with aplastic anemia. Blood chemistries are important. We often do check for hepatitis because after patients have had a hepatitis, there is an association with aplastic anemia. So that's important to know. There's also an aplastic anemia that can be associated with pregnancy. And so we, in females of the right age and the right context, this is something we might want to make sure isn't going on. PNH is something that we like to test for, as a lot of PNH clones can be found in aplastic anemia patients. We've talked a lot about short stature and if there's an inherited bone marrow problem. And there's a special test for something called Fanconi's anemia, which is associated with aplastic anemia as well. It's important to rule this out, especially in some of our younger patients. It's important for the patient in terms of treatment and also important for their family. And then telomeres. There's a lot of emerging literature and research in the telomere field, as we know that patients have, with very short telomeres can have forms of bone marrow failure like aplastic anemia. And DKC there is the abbreviation for dyskeratosis congenita, which we'll talk a little bit more about in a minute. And then finally, you really cannot make the diagnosis of aplastic anemia without, of course, having a bone marrow biopsy and sending the appropriate tests from it. This is just a list of drugs I have here for your reference. There's many others and probably even more than that that we don't know about that are associated with aplastic anemia, but these are some of the common drugs that if you know you've been exposed to them, it would be important to mention to your doctor. The first several are drugs for people who have seizure disorders. Chloramphenicol is an antibiotic. Methimazole and propylthiouracil are for thyroid conditions, and these have all been associated in the literature with causing aplastic anemia. I say medicine causes it, but what really causes acquired aplastic anemia, so this means somebody had normal blood counts and they acquired low blood counts over time, it's actually an autoimmune condition, and this is a nice pathophysiology that we feel like we have some understanding of through research. This is a complicated slide, and don't be overwhelmed by all the things on the picture, but the important thing to realize is this is a T cell. And T cells are a type of cell in the body which are actually a white blood cell that's associated with immunity. Over here is a stem cell. So this is the grandmother, the grandfather of the bone marrow that makes all the other blood cells. And this immune cell goes and attacks the grandfather cell. And we know that these grandfather cells have what we call CD34 cell surface markers, and they attack them. And then when this gets attacked, the word for cell death is apoptosis, and they're not able to make all the normal blood cells, and that's when you get the bone marrow failure. Once we know that you have bone marrow failure, we like to classify it a bit further. These were criteria that were actually developed quite a long time ago, but I still find them very helpful clinically, and they have a lot to do with how we treat patients who have aplastic anemia. If someone only has moderate aplastic anemia, it means that they wouldn't meet the criteria for severe disease, and we might actually treat them a little bit differently. Severe aplastic anemia, which as you can see is the column here in the middle, is probably what we'll focus the most on today, and then certainly very severe is a little bit worse than that. But you can have any two of the three after you're known to have a hypocellular bone marrow, which is less than 25%. An absolute neutrophil count of less than 500, and these are the good infection-fighting white cells, a low platelet count, and this would be before you're supported by transfusions, and then getting back to the reticulocyte count that we spoke about in the labs, this is a measure of bone marrow rebuilding or turnover, and if it's very low, this also suggests severe aplastic anemia. So throughout my talk today, you'll hear that about several patients, these are patients of my own in my clinic, that I think are illustrative of some of the things we have to think about in aplastic anemia. So the first I share with you is a 42-year-old lady, lovely woman with low blood counts who's been bruising very easily for about 8 months. And she actually brought with her old records, and so we knew from a physical 2 years ago that she had had normal blood counts. She had an absolute neutrophil count that was not in the normal range. The normal range would be about 1,500 and above, but she wasn't having infections and really wouldn't have known there was a problem if someone hadn't checked her counts. She was not needing red blood cell transfusions, and while her platelets are low, you can see there, they're 43,000, with the lower limit of normal being 150,000. She was not having any bleeding, and even her monthly cycles were not so heavy that it was causing a problem. So she has moderate aplastic anemia. And the rule of thumb that I use for patients with moderate aplastic anemia is that about one-third of patients might improve. About one-third will stay the same. Certainly, our patient's counts are low, but she doesn't necessarily need treatment because she's not having any troubles. And then, unfortunately, about a third will progress to severe aplastic anemia, and certainly that's the context in which needing treatment is appropriate. Some people could consider doing low-dose immunosuppression, something like a cyclosporine pill, orally alone in moderate aplastic anemia, or if there's a clinical trial, possibly, as there have been some over the last few years, that would be reasonable to enroll at that time. but otherwise we make sure that moderate aplastic anemia doesn't become severe aplastic anemia without our knowing, because that's when treatment really needs to be initiated. So then here's another patient example, a younger patient, 18 years old, 5'4", some people might consider this short, some people might not, who presented with non-traumatic retinal hemorrhages, so bleeding behind his eyes without having any reason why, and a lot of petechiae, those are small blood blisters under the skin in his mouth. Now, his counts are much lower, you'll see. Getting back to the Kamita criteria that we reviewed a moment ago, his absolute neutrophil count is under 500. His hemoglobin was very low when I met him, and his platelets were very low. Something that's always going to be mentioned when the blood counts are first known is, does the patient have leukemia? And in this particular situation, it was known that he didn't have any blasts on his blood smear when we looked at it or in his bone marrow, all reassuring against leukemia. But certainly you see here his other features would suggest that he does have severe aplastic anemia with a hypocellular bone marrow. His karyotype, or his chromosomes, were normal, and his reticulocyte count was very low, certainly for that degree of anemia. So the reason I mentioned that he was possibly a little bit shorter and also that he's young, 18, is in our younger patients, we always want to make sure that we're thinking about the diagnosis appropriately and differentiate between inherited versus acquired aplastic anemia. Acquired aplastic anemia, which is primarily what we've been speaking about up until now, is that immune attack that I showed you the picture of. It is an autoimmune disease, and it may be caused by one of the many medicines we talked about or infections, or we may never know what it's caused by. But we often treat that with immunosuppressive therapy or a bone marrow transplant, and it does have the possibility to evolve to myelodysplastic syndrome or even leukemia. Inherited aplastic anemia is actually a bit different. It's a genetic disorder. We don't always know the gene that causes it, though we know many potential causes, and there are some clear associations from the literature. It may have a little bit different presentation with the cytopenias initially. Maybe only one cell line is down of the three being the whites, the reds, and the platelets. It can be associated with other features, some of those nail or skin abnormalities that I was mentioning, or short stature or otherwise. And this is less likely to respond to immunosuppressive therapy because the mechanism of disease is not that T cell attack at the CD34 bone marrow stem cell. It's a genetic cause. But this too can evolve to MDS or AML. I think it's important in our younger patients to make sure that we've at least thought about, is there any congenital syndrome, because it may influence how we treat them. And it may be that we never see these patients before they get to the clonal evolution of AML or something else, but it's important to at least take that history and rule it out. I consider patients about age 30 to 40 as young patients who we need to make sure that we've at least been thoughtful about this. And that's because, as I mentioned, it can change how you treat them, and it's important to know that up front. We've already talked about the history and the physical. And then I mentioned here some of the other diagnoses that are genetic disorders that are associated with aplastic anemia and are well described to have these sort of problems. So then severe aplastic anemia in an older patient. In our younger patient you've seen, we have to make sure that we're ruling out an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome. In patients who are a little bit older, certainly 58 is not old, but just a little bit older than the younger child we spoke about a moment ago, we have to make sure, again, that we're for certain that the diagnosis is severe aplastic anemia. This is a lovely woman who presented very pale, having a lot of shortness of breath, and again, with very easy bruising. Also meets criteria for severe disease, as you can see with her blood counts on the right, needing transfusions, low platelets causing the bruising, and her low infection-fighting white cells with the ANC of 180. So the differential diagnosis in an older patient is actually more between myelodysplastic syndrome and aplastic anemia. You wouldn't think that someone at the age of 58 would have gotten to have an inherited bone marrow failure disorder without someone having noticed. But myelodysplastic syndrome is also an acquired type of bone marrow failure syndrome, and about 15% of those are what we call hypoplastic, or the low count, that empty marrow that I showed you in the first slide. And that could be confused with aplastic anemia. And again, it's better to have a sense of which it is in terms of going down your treatment path. The CD34 count, the number of those bone marrow stem cells that we talked about, is actually usually increased in myelodysplastic syndrome, whereas in aplastic anemia it's quite low because of the autoimmune attack that we've mentioned. Dyserythropoiesis is just a long word for funny-looking red cells, and those can actually be seen both in MDS and in aplastic anemia. Some of the other things in the left-hand column are things that are common in MDS, that dysplasia or funny-looking cells under the microscope, but we really don't see those with aplastic anemia. There's just a low level of cells. It's not that they're odd-looking. MDS patients can have a population of PNH cells, but it's not as common as it is in aplastic anemia. And the chromosomes, or the karyotype that I've mentioned, that we look at when we do the bone marrow biopsy, can be abnormal in both disorders, but it's much more likely to be abnormal in the myelodysplastic syndrome. So we've mentioned a lot of these tests, and I just wanted to review why they're useful. And you saw just in that compare and contrast graph in the previous slide that it does point you down one direction or another. And it may be that your doctor tells you you have hypoplastic MDS or you have aplastic anemia, we're not sure. And it may be that the treatment path follows one or both as you wait to know. But again, the karyotype is more likely to be abnormal in the hypoplastic MDS, and you're more likely to have a very low CD34 count with aplastic anemia. The PNH clones certainly are getting a lot of interest these days, and they're a population of cells that all come from the same stem cell in the bone marrow, and they're found in most patients with acquired aplastic anemia. The size of this population can vary widely, and this may be a source of some discussion between you and your physician, because again, it could have therapeutic implications if there seems to be more of a problem from the PNH clone than from the aplastic anemia itself. Patients with MDS can also have a PNH population, these cells that are picked up by the flow cytometric assay, but they don't all necessarily come from the same grandmother cell in the bone marrow, and this probably means a lot less in myelodysplastic syndrome than it does in aplastic anemia. But I think that these are important things for us to know about our patients because it may predict response to immunosuppressive therapy. This is not completely clear from the literature, but there's a suggestion that it really does matter, that if you have a PNH clone, you will be more likely to respond to immunosuppressive therapy and thus have a better prognosis if you have aplastic anemia. Just because you don't have a PNH clone doesn't mean you'll do poorly. It's nothing like that, but it's something that may suggest up front how things are going to happen. There's also some lovely work from the NIH that an HLA-DR15 predicts response to immunosuppressive therapy in people who have hypoplastic myelodysplastic syndrome. So again, if this is checked in you, it may suggest that even if people feel you might have hypoplastic MDS, starting with immunosuppressive therapy for these bone marrow failure disorders is a good thing. And then lastly, telomeres, which we'll talk a little bit more about in a moment, have been shown to, if they're shorter, suggest that you're more likely to have an increased incidence of relapse after immunosuppressive therapy, or more likely to have clonal evolution to something like a leukemia. And again, it matters to us, and here's some of the primary literature and graphs. You'll get used to seeing these type of graphs throughout my talk, and I hope you'll find them helpful. But we always look at this y-axis first, and this is overall response. So being higher, you know, closer to 100% is good. And this just shows that people who have a PNH clone months after they've started treatment are more likely to have responded than people who don't. But you'll see that people who don't have a PNH clone still certainly have a response rate. And this was a single study, but I think it is suggestive. And if it is really true that MDS is the diagnosis and not aplastic anemia, these are patients that have a bit of a shorter survival time. And this is survival, different than the axis over here. But this suggests that as you go down, these are less people surviving. And so you can see that people with hypoplastic MDS do a little bit less well than people with aplastic anemia. And that's why we go to these lengths to sort this out during diagnosis, because we think it's helpful for the patients to have a context in which to know what's going on. Getting back to telomeres, I wanted to explain this a little bit more since it's an area of active research for the field. Telomeres are the ends of chromosomes, and they're regions of repetitive nucleotides. And they're intended to be there to protect the chromosomes from damage and breakdown. This DKC that I've mentioned, the dyskeratosis congenita, has very short telomeres. And it can be very helpful in making that diagnosis for the patient. Again, some lovely work, and I've placed the references at the bottom of my slide out of the NIH, suggests that telomeres, when measured by PCR, can be short in up to one-third of patients with acquired severe aplastic anemia. So again, this is not a genetic disorder like dyskeratosis, but the people do have shorter telomeres. And while it may not predict who's likely to respond to immunosuppressive therapy, it may tell us who is more likely to relapse or have clonal evolution, and this is an ongoing area of research in the field. So now that I hope everyone has a reasonable understanding of why we do many of the tests that we do to get the diagnosis, to make sure we get it right for our patients, we have to decide about what's the appropriate treatment. So again, I'll bring a case from my own clinic, a 16-year-old male who had a school physical, and again with the bruising, it always gets back to these physical signs that are really reasons to take yourself to the doctor if you're having a lot of bruising. And he, again, this was likely to be acquired because he had had a physical the year prior and things were normal. He meets severe aplastic anemia criteria, as we've discussed. He also has a very small PNH clone. So how do we decide how to treat him? I've told you he's had a PNH clone. Does that mean we should just do immunosuppressive therapy and it's all okay? Not necessarily. He's a young gentleman. He's only 16. So treatment is definitely affected by age, and that we factor that in very highly when we're making our treatment recommendations. And then also whether or not there's a potential donor for bone marrow transplant. We're going to spend a lot of time on this in the second half of our talk. The availability of a matched sibling donor is really one of the key branch points between you and your doctor of how the treatment is going to be decided upon. So we know that if a patient has a matched sibling, and you'll see here this HLA identical sibling, and the patient is less than 20 years old, they actually do very well. So this is another one where the probability of survival is on the y-axis, and you can see a higher line on the graph is better. And so if you have a matched sibling, you do the best if you're young. If you're a little bit older, you still do fine, but you might not do quite as well as someone who's young. And if you're young and you don't have a matched sibling and you only have an unrelated donor, this is something that might be a point of discussion. And then certainly patients who are older than 20 and don't have a matched sibling, they only have an unrelated donor, they really don't do as well. So this is a schematic of how I think about how I would treat a young patient. And again, everyone defines young a little bit differently, but I think in the field, less than age 30 to 40 years old, this is really a fairly standard paradigm. If you have a matched sibling, you go automatically to stem cell transplant, and that's important to realize here. If you don't have a matched sibling, your first path is going to be to immunosuppressive therapy, and then we'll have to follow along. So I'd like to take you through some of the primary data for why we do that. Children, adolescents, and young adults go quickly, and I've mentioned that to you a couple times. And the reason we do that is because in large studies over many years of a lot of young patients with aplastic anemia, we know that there's a marked decrease in the relapse of the aplastic anemia after a matched sibling transplant. And this also decreases the risk of the aplastic anemia evolving into myelodysplastic syndrome or to PNH. So something that really should be encouraged, and I think your doctor would do this, but it never hurts to bring it up, is push them a little bit and make sure that they're thinking about typing. And so if you have siblings or you have a child with aplastic anemia and you have other children, encourage the doctor to send their blood for typing. And typing is not a large endeavor. It doesn't commit the person who gets typed necessarily to a bone marrow transplant, but it's a blood test that can be sent for the appropriate things to know if the patient with aplastic anemia has any full sibling matches. And this really should be done fairly soon after the diagnosis of aplastic anemia is made. You know, within the first, week or two of this diagnosis and everything getting situated, this is a very important next step. And when you're thinking about a bone marrow transplant, it probably sounds a little bit daunting or scary, but we have a lot of studies which show us what helps us know who's going to do a little bit better. And the predictors of survival actually have been pretty clear and consistent more recently. I told you age is one of them, and that's one of the graphics I'll show you next. The matched sibling donor is key. One of the reasons I encourage the prompt initiation of the bone marrow typing is because the sooner that the bone marrow typing is done, the sooner that if there is a matched sibling, the patient can get to a bone marrow transplant. And in the study that I reference in the bottom right-hand corner, we know that time from the diagnosis of the aplastic anemia to the time that the bone marrow transplant starts, if it is shorter, less than about 80 days, that patients do better. And that stands to reason because it's less time that the patient is not making their own blood and platelets, and it's less time to get an infection. Something that I'll also show you the data of is that we in aplastic anemia have the sense that using bone marrow as opposed to a peripheral blood stem cell transplant really is better, and that's an important distinction, and I think pretty agreed upon in the field. And then the part of the treatment that comes before the bone marrow transplant is actually given, that's called the conditioning regimen. If that does not contain radiation, that's probably okay. We use chemotherapy medicines like ATG, which is anti-thymocyte globulin, or something called CAMPATH or alemtuzumab, also can be part of the preparative regimen, and patients do well with these with a matched sibling transplant. So again, the overall survival curves that we've been looking at. So here is the younger patients, and they do just a little bit better than the older patients over time, but you can see this is in terms of percent survival. Even if you're a little bit older and you have a matched sibling, you have a 68% chance at 120 months of surviving after a bone marrow transplant for aplastic anemia. And those are pretty good numbers. Certainly we want to find ways to get it to 100% for everybody, but in this context you should feel reassured about how you can do if you have a matched sibling transplant. As I mentioned, efficiency is important in our field, and this is an example of one of the reasons that we go straight to bone marrow transplant. We don't, if somebody has a matched sibling, so these are all younger children here who have HLA identical siblings, if they went straight to transplant without getting immunosuppressive therapy with ATG and cyclosporin before the transplant, they actually did better than if people got the immunosuppressive therapy and waited to get the bone marrow transplant. And so this is some of the little bit older literature that is reasons why we try and move these patients so promptly to transplant. So I've mentioned the conditioning regimen, and you'll probably hear about what we call Cy-ATG. It's just how we abbreviate it. The Cy is cyclophosphamide. It's an immunosuppressive medicine, but it's not what we would call marrow ablative. And this means that it actually doesn't permanently kill the stem cells, and this is important actually for fertility reasons, which we'll talk about in a minute, but you should realize that cyclophosphamide is not myeloablative. It does have some side effects, and these are things to be mindful of, but I think the risks of untreated aplastic anemia are outweighed by the side effects of the conditioning regimen for the transplant. It can affect the heart a little bit. It can cause some bleeding in the bladder. That's what hemorrhagic cystitis is, but we have good ways to treat this and prevent it, and it does cause the loss of hair. Antithymocyte globulin, which a lot of studies were done over the years to show that this helps prevent graft rejection and also graft versus host disease, and these are two potential side effects of the bone marrow transplant itself. We found that when you add the ATG, patients do a lot better in that context. And we talked about how there was a study that showed that radiation, or XRT, as we sometimes abbreviate it, has longer-term toxicities, and it's probably not needed. So a standard of care bone marrow transplant for a young patient with a matched sibling donor would be cyclophosphamide and ATG. This gets back to the fact that we think bone marrow transplant using actual bone marrow as opposed to peripheral blood stem cells is important. And this may seem complicated, which it's not intended to, but this again is the reversed axis. So this is percent probability. So higher numbers are not as good. So when these lines get higher, you'd rather have them have be down here lower. And so this was a group of younger and older patients that were studied over time using peripheral blood stem cells as the stem cell donor for the transplant or bone marrow stem cells as the donor for the transplant. And if you're younger and get a bone marrow transplant, you actually have only about 12% graft versus host disease. And unfortunately, if you're older, over age 20, and you get peripheral blood, you do less well. And this is some of the literature that we cite as to why we do use bone marrow in patients who have aplastic anemia as opposed to peripheral blood stem cells. This isn't always true in some other disorders. Again, survival is always important, and this is the same sort of axis, but it's better to be higher on this because we want higher percent probability of survival. And again, it shows you that you're more likely to survive if you're young and you get a bone marrow transplant as opposed to being older and the bottom line, which is peripheral blood and a little bit older. So if it comes up or the donor has an issue, this might be one reason to suggest you really pick a donor who has the ability to have a bone marrow harvest. Sounds like we're sort of down on older people with everyone doing better if they're younger, but that's not the case. It's just a reason that we don't rush to bone marrow transplant in the older patients, and it's because they survive a little bit less well, as you've seen in some of these curves, and their graft versus host disease, which is a long-term complication after bone marrow transplant, is more. And these are just some figures that show that this was a group of people, all adults, that were studied, that they have higher rates of acute graft versus host disease as well as higher rates of chronic graft versus host disease than our younger patients, and they survive a little bit less well. Doesn't mean we won't do bone marrow transplants in older patients, but it's part of why the algorithm, as I showed you, was to go to immunosuppressive therapy first. And here I have two additional patients that will illustrate this for us. So a 12-year-old male with severe aplastic anemia getting transfusions every week and only has one sister. That sister was typed very promptly, of course. And when you're typing a sibling, they have roughly a 25% chance of being a full match, a 50% chance of being a half match, and a 25% chance of being what we call disparate. And if they are disparate, they are not a match and they can't be used. This is an older patient who's in a similar situation with severe aplastic anemia, getting a lot of transfusions, and what should we do? Well, as we've talked about, the other very reasonable option is immunosuppressive therapy. And this is shown in this graphic here for older patients or those who don't have suitable donors. So they get immunosuppressive therapy up front, and then we follow them for a response. If they don't respond in these older patients, then we might need to consider a transplant, which I'll talk a bit more about in a minute. So this immunosuppressive therapy that we keep talking about, it is standard of care. Interestingly enough, it is that ATG again, which you remember from the conditioning regimen for the matched sibling transplant, the antithymocyte globulin. It does come from a horse or a rabbit. We'll focus mainly on horse here. And then cyclosporin, which is a pill form immunosuppressive agent. So the response rate, and this has been studied for many years in many different centers and venues, is between about 60 and 70%. And really, that's pretty good. Yes, we're trying to find ways to make it better, but always want to do something that we know has a proven track record. So horse is thought to be a little bit better than rabbit, at least as illustrated in this study that was presented in the New England Journal of Medicine from the National Institutes of Health, which showed, as you can see here, that at 3 months, if you got horse ATG, about 62% of people had responded by 3 months. And 68% by 6 months. And so it does take some time. You know, 3 months I know is not nothing, and there's transfusions and monitoring for infections that whole time. But it's something that we wait out, and we see that people are likely going to respond. We do usually in the United States start with horse ATG because of studies such as this one, which suggests it might be a little bit better than rabbit. But if rabbit's all that's available, this is certainly a reasonable form of immunosuppressive therapy. We've talked about the response. There is an incidence of relapse, and that just means how many people relapse after 3 years. It's a little bit less than a third of patients. And in this study, this clonal evolution that I keep talking about, a little bit less than a quarter of patients ultimately developed MDS, which is something that is a clonal problem that can evolve out of aplastic anemia, and leukemia is also a clonal problem that comes from MDS, and the continuum of MDS to leukemia in these patients may be long or it may be very short. Some other studies have a little bit higher incidence of relapse at 5 years, as much as 35%. And the other thing that people can evolve to is more of a pure PNH picture. If you had a small PNH clone, you got ATG and cyclosporin, later it might be that your PNH clone gets a lot bigger over time and may need to be treated more in a PNH paradigm as opposed to the aplastic anemia. But something that's very happy and helpful is even if people got ATG, responded, didn't respond, what have you, there's still very high survival at 3 years. And this is important and because there's always more treatments coming through in a research way or clinical trials so that we can continue moving forward for our patients. One side effect of ATG to mention is serum sickness, and this is a reaction to the horse or the rabbit proteins, and it's actually an immune complex hypersensitivity reaction. It's not that fun. It's temporary, usually, and it can be treated, but the patient will feel very fluish while they're getting the ATG. They can look flushed, have high fevers, and I do mean high, 102, 103, 39 degrees Celsius, those kind of numbers, and a lot of aches and pains in their muscles. It usually starts within about 4 to 10 days after the first dose of ATG was given, and that's the reason that we give steroids when we give the ATG. And so methylprednisolone is just one form of steroid, and it's given usually through the veins, dosed by weight, along with the ATG. And I know some people think steroids are bad, and while they certainly have long-term side effects, it's real important to make sure that you get the steroids when you're getting the ATG so that the serum sickness is not too bad. One thing I'll just mention briefly is another form of immunosuppressive therapy. This is more unique to Hopkins, which is where I am, but we call it high-dose Cy, high-dose cyclophosphamide. You'll see these drugs and these paradigms are all the same, just in a little bit different ways, but high-dose is considered 50 milligrams per kilogram, again given 4 days, similar to the ATG. This was a study that was done here and had a very similar response rate as to what you saw with ATG, about 70%. It's in some ways more toxic, and there was a study at the NIH that suggested that, but with the appropriate support and the appropriate transfusions and time, people do very well with it. And you can see here that if you've never had ATG and you just got high-dose cyclophosphamide as your initial immunosuppressive therapy, people really did quite well. This is the overall survival, and this is the failure-free survival that people do really well. And this is a paradigm that we're quite comfortable with here in the appropriate patient population. There's a lot of supportive care that goes along with treatment for aplastic anemia. I mentioned them here because they may be things that you ask your doctor about. You'll probably need a central venous catheter. You know you're getting blood transfusions, but you want to make sure that they're irradiated and leukofiltered. Growth factors, you may have heard of these shots, erythropoietin or Neupogen, Neulasta. They may have some benefit to the patient in the clinic, but they don't induce disease remissions, and they shouldn't be thought of as anything more than possibly a Band-Aid just in the right clinical situation. My personal practice is not to use them very much. A question I get not infrequently is if you can give red blood cells and platelet transfusions, can you give white cell transfusions? While it's possible, it's something that we don't think helps very much and we don't do very often. But certainly to fight your infections, you're going to get a lot of antibiotics. There's also a lot of late effects after bone marrow transplant or after immunosuppressive therapy. We've talked about the secondary hematologic malignancies. These are the MDS and the AML that we have to be mindful about. There can be impaired fertility. This is certainly a lot more with bone marrow transplant than with just immunosuppressive therapy alone. But to be clear, this would not be a reason, even in a young patient, that I would want to withhold a matched sibling bone marrow transplant. And it's important to know that there are some studies that if you got the ATG and cyclophosphamide non-myeloablative conditioning that we talked about, the majority of patients will be able to have successful reproduction after that. And something else to be mindful of is your bone health. If you've gotten a whole lot of steroids in the context of serum sickness for immunosuppressive therapy or your bone marrow transplant, just make sure that if you have hip pain or joint pain, they check to make sure that you haven't had breakdown of your hips called avascular necrosis. I've seen this a few times in my own patient practice. It's just something to image and make sure that the proper treatment has been initiated. So now what to do if the patient is relapsed or refractory? And I give you two examples here of a young patient and an older patient who unfortunately neither one had a long-term response to immunosuppressive therapy. The first one is someone who is primary refractory, and the second gentleman is somebody who relapsed at a little bit less than 2 years after treatment. So what should we do? And I show here this schematic. It's from a lovely article put out by the American Society of Hematology, written by Dr. Scheinberg and Young, and it shows a lot of the path we've talked about before, but it suggests what to do in this relapsed or refractory setting. Some people suggest that you could repeat rabbit ATG. Some people suggest a sibling transplant at that point, possibly with an alternative donor, and to me, alternative donor means someone who's not related to you, someone who's related but only a partial match, not this full match sibling that we've talked about, or initiation of a clinical trial intended to try and give the patient the best option based on the most up-to-date research. So these unrelated donor or alternative BMT, we know that the sooner the better. Again, this concept of efficiency, after relapse or refractoriness is noted, let's get moving on looking for the unrelated donor or the typing of the siblings or other people that might not have been typed before. Bone marrow is still going to be the best source, more so than the peripheral blood stem cells, as we discussed. The conditioning regimens are very similar. the ATG and cyclosporin. Another chemotherapy might be added, such as the CAM path I mentioned, or something else called fludarabine that we see on occasion. And these, again, are forms of chemotherapy. These unrelated donors can be found through the National Marrow Donor Program. Sometimes they're affectionately called MUDs, matched unrelated donor. Haploidentical donors, which is something I have a good bit of familiarity with here. And these are people who are half-matched. And then the last form of an alternative donor is an umbilical cord donor. And there's a lot of discussions about cord blood, I know, at the time of people having children, whether or not to save that and bank it. To review some of the literature on unrelated donors in children, this is a small study, but they used some of the medicines that I discussed, the fludarabine, cyclophosphamide, and the alemtuzumab for the conditioning regimen. And all of these, or most of them, 40 out of 44 of these children had failed immunosuppressive therapy, and they actually did very well from a survival perspective after getting a transplant from an unrelated donor. And this is a reason that this should be pursued if a person doesn't respond. Adult unrelated donors also is something that's been studied a lot more recently. In the past, the outcomes were not quite as good in the older adults, as you saw, and certainly not without a matched sibling. But the survival now, with better transfusional support, better antibiotics, is approaching about 75%, and very similar conditioning regimens, as I've been mentioning. And adults, we still aren't completely sure, I think, but we may need to add radiation in that particular setting when we don't have a matched sibling, and we're trying something in the relapsed and refractory setting. This is some data that was put together very nicely by the Center for International Blood and Marrow Transplant Research for me, and it's really just a summary of a lot of what I was telling you, but it gives you some figures for the United States over really the last 20 years. That shows you how people do by donor type, age group, and graft source. And it's reaffirmation of the things that we've been studying through the literature in the past few slides of having a matched sibling is important, age is important, and if you have an unrelated donor, it's something we can get you through, but it may just be a little bit less well than if you'd had a matched sibling donor up front. Umbilical cord transplants is something that's still an active area of research, but the survival is certainly lower. And some of this is because the conditioning regimens are a bit more varied. Still the cyclophosphamide, the fludarabine, some even use melphalan. A study from Japan, which actually was more promising than anything we'd seen in umbilical cords recently, showed in 12 adult patients that the bone marrow transplant, or in this case, the umbilical cord transplant, did take 11 out of 12 engrafted, that's the word we use for that, and 10 out of 12 of them were still alive at 36 months. And this is a good thing, I would say, but again, an area of active research. Half-match transplants, or these haploidentical transplants, reserved in the refractory setting, usually done in a specialist center, also often done in the setting of a clinical trial because it's something we're working to improve. Certainly in leukemia or other malignancies, the results are very similar to those who do have a fully matched sibling. And the nice thing about these haploidentical transplants is nearly everybody has a donor. So you may recall I mentioned that about 50% of siblings are likely to be a half match. And so one of the things that I think is important in studying half match transplants is that if you don't have an unrelated donor, but maybe some of your siblings or even parents or cousins may be able to be a half-matched donor. And we do have a trial open here in this context. So to summarize, the ideal therapy for severe aplastic anemia is available to all the patients. It wouldn't be limited by age, donor status, or availability. It would have a low toxicity. I think I've shown you examples of how a matched sibling transplant fits these criteria in terms of low toxicity and how immunosuppressive therapy right now is available to all patients and also has a relatively low toxicity. And then we need to make sure that we're at least looking for, following, or choosing treatment options that reduce or eliminate the evolution to MDS or leukemia or PNH. Here's the final slide, just a summary of a lot of what I've told you, and I'm certainly happy to take any more specific questions if I glossed over something you wanted to know more about or otherwise. But make sure your diagnosis is correct and move efficiently to your treatment. There's a lot of different treatment options, and your doctor will talk you through what's the best based on your age, your donor availability, where you are, and the side effect profile of the treatment. And not to lose hope, certainly that even if you are refractory or you have relapsed severe aplastic anemia, there's a lot of trials going on, unrelated and mismatched donors can be done at that point in time. Certainly, I'd like to thank the Aplastic Anemia and MDS International Foundation for giving me the opportunity to interact with you like this. And these are some of my colleagues here where I work, and certainly my patients I'm very appreciative to for all their help. I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. DeZern. We did have a couple of questions come in during your talk. The first question is, my husband was diagnosed with aplastic anemia in October of 2012. He received ATD treatment in November of that same year, and he is now on cyclosporin, and his platelet count is at 75. What can I expect for his recovery and prognosis?
Well, from that bit of information that you've shared, I'm very happy that the platelet count is at 75,000, because that would be a platelet count sufficiently high to prevent any spontaneous bleeding. If, in fact, the platelet count is improved and no transfusions are being received in terms of red blood cells, this sounds like a favorable response. And over time, the counts will continue to be monitored, and it may be that the cyclosporin could be tapered off, or it may not be. It depends on how the blood counts do and if the cyclosporin is currently being kept at therapeutic levels. But it's not uncommon to, you know, I guess, treat it in November and we're here in August, so 9 months later. It sounds like there was a response. And over time, if the cyclosporin can be tapered off and that response maintained, that would be a very good outcome. And then repeated count monitoring to make sure that things stay like that is very reasonable. And it may be that the cyclosporin gets tapered a little bit and the platelet count starts to drop, and that would suggest that the cyclosporin level needs to stay where it is.
Thank you. The next question relates to one of the things you covered in your talk. Can the hepatitis B shot cause aplastic anemia? It seems this person was on no meds prior to the diagnosis, but after their injection or the shot, they were diagnosed with aplastic anemia.
So I certainly have learned in medicine, never say never, while hepatitis is thought to be associated with aplastic anemia, like having the virus itself, one of the viruses, or having an autoimmune-type hepatitis is certainly associated with aplastic anemia, the vaccine has not been described as such. So I couldn't say for certain that it was causal. A good majority of aplastic anemia cases are what we call idiopathic, or a diagnosis cause is never really arrived at by the physicians. So sorry to hedge a little bit on that one, but I'm not sure that it's related. And I think something that may be of comfort is one way or another, the aplastic anemia needs to be treated in the ways that we've talked about.
Thank you. Dr. DeZern, is MDS a cancer or pre-leukemia?
It's a fair question, and some of this is how you think about things. I myself consider things in a spectrum, and I do consider myelodysplastic syndrome a pre-cancer because it has the potential to become leukemia. And some people find it disconcerting to call it a cancer, but it's very analogous to a colon polyp that has the ability to become a colon cancer. We have to make sure that we're treating it in ways that we recognize what it is and what it could become.
Thank you. The next question is slightly long, but I will do my best to read it to you. I had ATG horse treatment in 2008 and was on cyclosporin for 1 year. My last blood count, which was late last year, showed all normal counts. I marked my 5 years in November of 2013. My doctor says I'm no longer in the woods. Does this mean I'm in remission or on the way to full recovery? This person is 52 years old.
Well, if the count's normalized, certainly it sounds like remission. And if it's really been 5 years since 2008 ATG, that sounds like a very excellent response that has been maintained over some time. And certainly I wouldn't never see your doctor again, but I think much less frequent blood counts, if they're normal now, would be reasonable, maybe once or twice a year at the most.
Thank you. We just have a few more questions. Are there any data on how well patients do with a half-match sibling if there are no siblings with a full match?
We have some data here from our own institution, and there's some data from Asia. These are both places where half-match transplants are done with a greater degree of frequency. And we think that patients do almost just as well as with full-match siblings.
Thank you. This is a severe aplastic anemia patient who's 16 years old and female. She was treated with immunosuppressive therapies 2 years ago and had a very slow response, I think 1 year later. Today, the RBC and WBC are normal, platelets 100. Any guess on the prognosis?
That sounds very favorable. You didn't mention as to whether or not off immunosuppressive therapy altogether now or not. But if the patient is, in fact, completely off immunosuppressive therapy, I would say that the prognosis is quite favorable. Some of the numbers that we reviewed, that about a third of patients or maybe a little bit less relapse at 3 years. I think the important things, certainly in a younger patient, to monitor after immunosuppressive therapy and after the immunosuppression has been stopped, is to make sure blood counts are checked, few times a year, maybe four, maybe a little bit more, looking for clonal evolution, if the PNH clone, if there was one, is enlarging or not, if there's any suggestion that there's progression to something like MDS. So these are very low numbers, to be clear, certainly under 10% for progressing to MDS. And then about a third of patients who relapse. That would be probably the most important reason to check blood counts. But again, it sounds like the patient's done very well.
Thank you. Would you mind explaining the difference between aplastic anemia and severe aplastic anemia?
Sure, I don't mind at all. Let's see. Let me see if I can go back. The main difference is actually just in the counts, and I've brought up here the Kmita criteria again, and this is how I think about it. Aplastic anemia encompasses the whole concept of low blood counts in a hypocellular or aplastic bone marrow, and we characterize severe fairly carefully because it's people who have two of the three, an absolute neutrophil count of less than 500, a platelet count of less than 20,000, and a reticulocyte count of less than 60,000. So the severe part of it really is defined in the context of the specific blood counts.
Thank you. This next question is in relation to someone's maternal grandmother who acquired aplastic anemia from benzene exposure in the 50s. Is there any hereditary link between this type of aplastic anemia?
It doesn't sound like it. It's called acquired because it was caused by something that wasn't in one of the cells that are transmitted genetically. So I wouldn't feel anxious about that.
Thank you. Can allergy shots cause aplastic anemia or relapse if the person had AA and then underwent ATG?
Again, I never say never, but if someone has truly had a response to the ATG in terms of immunosuppressive therapy for the aplastic anemia and an allergy shot is needed, for a medical reason. It wouldn't be a reason to withhold that, to think that it would cause a relapse. It's not one of the more known associations, and so I wouldn't feel too concerned.
Thank you. This next question is related to, is it common that someone who's 87 is diagnosed with MDS?
Well, how you define common, I think, is of some debate, but certainly as we age, all parts of our body become weakened, the bone marrow being no different. And there is a subset of people at an older age who can have this myelodysplastic syndrome. Whether or not it needs to be treated or is causing any problems, I think, is another question.
Thank you. This question is related to, it looks like, an experimental drug / clinical trial. This person has an opportunity to participate in a clinical trial that uses ATG, CSA, and a new medicine, eltrombopag, or generic Promacta. Do you know anything about the new drug, and would you recommend the trial?
I'm familiar with the trial as well as with the drug. I think and believe that the trial that is being referred to is open at the National Institutes of Health. And I think if the patient is comfortable with the concept of clinical research, which I would encourage a patient to be, and they meet eligibility criteria for the clinical trial, then I think it's a very reasonable approach. The experimental portion of that, the eltrombopag or the Promacta, is a medication intended to stimulate platelets specifically. Thrombopoietin is a growth factor for platelets, and there's also receptors for this molecule on all stem cells, and so the theory in the trial is that it will help stimulate the bone marrow to start making more blood cells. So I would, if the patient is eligible for the clinical trial, I think it's a very appropriate and reasonable treatment path.
Thank you. Our son was treated in 2009 at the age of 18 with ATG. Within 80 days of initial symptoms, he responded exceedingly well and currently has normal blood counts. Once in remission, what does that mean for secondary PNH, MDS, or leukemia?
So, a good question, and I'm glad he's had such a nice response. So the numbers are similar to the same that I spoke about a minute ago. The clonal evolution to MDS and PNH, these are low values. It's something we monitor for because these are complications we don't want our patients to have. But they're low values, you know, under 10%, 5%. I don't know if he had a PNH clone to begin with, but you won't evolve with PNH if you didn't have a PNH clone when you were diagnosed. And in terms of the monitoring afterwards, the blood counts will be suggestive, and it should not be something that people live in fear of. It's just something that's on the doctor's mind when they're checking the CBC and making sure that the counts are staying the same.
Thank you. This is a follow-up to the allergy question. Would the allergy shot cause, would that affect the remission of the, pardon me, would receiving the allergy shot affect the remission from ATG?
Affect the remission specifically? No. And even if, you know, in the unfortunate situation that the aplastic anemia were to relapse, I really don't think that it would necessarily be from the allergy shot itself. But if it's the same person that had ATG approximately 5 years ago, I would feel comfortable getting the allergy shots if they're medically needed.
Thank you. And the follow-up to the question about the 87-year-old with MDS, they currently have fatigue and arthritis symptoms. Currently, they have not had any bone marrow biopsy. What do you recommend for treatment?
I'm sorry, Cottrell. Go through it with me one more time. So they just...
Sure. This is in reference to the person who was diagnosed with at the age of 87 with MDS. They currently have fatigue and arthritis symptoms, but they have not had any bone marrow biopsy. What would you recommend as a treatment?
Well, it's very hard to recommend treatment in that context. If no bone marrow biopsy was done, I guess I wouldn't be quite certain how the diagnosis of MDS was arrived at. But if fatigue is the only symptom and the patient is not needing a lot of blood cell transfusions, or even if they are needing red blood cell transfusions, a path of what I would call supportive care, making sure the patient has the best quality of life with getting a few blood transfusions and making sure that everything is done to optimize the energy and minimize any discomfort from the arthritis. I think that's a reasonable treatment paradigm. If the MDS really requires treatment, there's a lot of potential treatments for myelodysplastic syndrome that I think are maybe a little outside of the scope of this particular talk, but could be discussed with the doctor if they were appropriate. Again, the transfusional support, perhaps growth factor support alone, something like an erythropoietin or G-CSF, or then there's the demethylating agents, which is a whole other category of treatment for myelodysplastic syndrome.
Thank you. If there's a patient who relapses a few months after completing immunosuppressive treatment, can the patient get back under control by returning to cyclosporine treatments, or does that patient have to go back to square one with ATG?
That's a good question. I think one that probably isn't completely clear in the field, but in my own practice, if someone starts to relapse a few months after tapering of the immunosuppression and you get right back on the cyclosporin alone, often that may be enough to hold the patient for another good duration of time if they truly had a good response to begin with. If they really are relapsing in a way that is not able to be controlled with cyclosporin, going back to ATG or square one, as the patient described, isn't necessarily the next option. It may be that a clinical trial or a bone marrow transplant is the appropriate treatment at that point in time.
Thank you. The next question is, my son was diagnosed in January 2012 with severe aplastic anemia, received ATG in March, and became transfusion independent in July of 2012. His red blood counts and platelets have returned to livable levels, but his ANC hovers around 500 to 700. It does seem to go higher when he has an infection. Is this the normal response?
It's hard to say what is normal, but I think what is reassuring about that story is that the transfusion independence and the fact that the absolute neutrophil count is staying at a level that sounds like it's preventing infections, anything above 500, while certainly I know it's not normal, I find it reassuring that the patient does have the ability to augment the white count and mount a response to infections. And so I think that certainly it sounds as if the young gentleman is a little bit on the edge of tipping back over into aplastic anemia. He sounds like this is something that, with close monitoring, can be followed. But I don't know that I would say it's the normal. It sounds like it's not a full remission, but maybe has had a response. Depends on where he started.
Thank you. This patient had a URD transplant 20 months ago. They are currently 56, and their counts are well within normal guidelines. Low normal. They feel pretty well and have some mild fatigue. They were wondering what their long-term survival may be. Also, what else should they be looking forward to, i.e., PNH or leukemia?
Well, that's a little bit different situation. I mean, that actually sounds great. So an unrelated donor transplant 20 months ago in a 56-year-old who's normalized accounts. My hope would be that is taken, you know, if you have a PNH clone, you get a transplant, the PNH clone goes away. And the same would be true of the concerning clone to evolve to MDS from the aplastic anemia. So overall, it sounds like that person is in a very good spot at 20 months.
Thank you. After 5 years of successful ATG treatment, is there a possibility that the aplastic anemia would evolve into another bone marrow failure disease, MDS, leukemia, or PNH?
5 years is getting pretty far out, which is a good thing. And I wouldn't say never, but it's becoming much less likely over time if the counts are truly normal now. But again, it's something always to be monitored by, because if there was a malignant clone, it does take time for it to grow out. And at 5 years, you just have to keep monitoring, but should feel fairly comfortable about where you are.
Dr. DeZern, at what point after treatment or during recovery would it be okay for a female who was diagnosed with severe aplastic anemia to consider reproduction?
It's a good question and one we get a lot. A lot of it depends on what the etiology of the aplastic anemia was thought to be. If it was pregnancy associated the first time, it would be a different discussion, but we'll assume that it wasn't. And if the patient is truly in remission, then certainly an off immunosuppressive therapy and any medications that could be teratogens to the fetus, it's reasonable to attempt reproduction.
What does one ask for to test clonal evolution?
Sorry, Katrella, you bleeped out. I didn't hear you.
My apologies. What does one ask for to test clonal evolution?
Oh, a good question, and one I should have mentioned during my slides. So the PNH clone is a blood test and one that can be just checked periodically after treatment, both before and after treatment. And the clonal evolution I mentioned, we don't like to be running in and getting bone marrows just all the time for surveillance in our patients, but the karyotype and something called the FISH, which stands for fluorescent in situ hybridization, can be monitored both in the bone marrow or in the peripheral blood if someone is known to have a clone. But if the counts start going down, usually at that point in time we do a bone marrow biopsy because of the change in the peripheral blood counts, and that is when we might see that clonal evolution that I've been talking about.
Thank you. This question is in relation to someone's mother who's being treated with MDS, which turned into AML within a matter of weeks. Unfortunately, she passed away at the age of 81. Is this common to have such a rapid progression?
Yes, I'm very sorry for the loss of your mother, and the story that you tell is not an uncommon one. Back to the question that I think someone asked earlier about, is MDS a cancer? This is in part why I think it, at times, while scary, is helpful to call it a cancer or a precancer, because the dividing line between what we call MDS and what we call AML can be very blurry. On paper, AML is greater than 20% blasts, but if the diagnosis of MDS is up to 20% blasts and a person has 17 or 19% blasts, they're just right on the edge and can cross over to that threshold, unfortunately, very quickly. And I know that's hard, certainly on the patient and then on their loved ones.
Dr. DeZern, can serum sickness occur post-CAMPATH treatment if they had that instead of the ATG for aplastic anemia?
True serum sickness, which, as I mentioned, is actually a reaction to the horse protein itself, wouldn't be what we would we wouldn't call it serum sickness, but all medications that are monoclonal antibodies can have some of these type problems. So the symptoms may be similar, and that may be what the patient's feeling or experiencing.
Thank you. I had ATG at the end of March. The following week, I had esophageal spasms. My doctor then tested me for PNH, which presented at 12%. Does this mean I have 12% clone, and could the ATG have caused the onset of PNH, or was it just a coincidence?
So that's an interesting question, and my guess is that the PNH clone of 12%, and I don't know if it was in the red cells or the white cells or exactly where it was, but was probably there before the ATG, and esophageal spasm certainly is a symptom of PNH. And I'd have to see some of the other labs to see if there are other symptoms associated with the PNH, such as the breakdown of the red blood cells or the hemolysis. But I don't mean to imply that the ATG in any way is causal. It's that when you have immunosuppressive therapy for that T cell attack at the stem cell level, it suppresses that autoimmune attack that's causing the aplastic anemia, but these other clones, if it's a PNH clone or an MDS clone, may have the ability to grow back up once that issue has been taken out of the equation by the ATG. but with respect to this particular question for this individual, I don't think that the ATG caused it, but it may be that the PNH symptoms are certainly causing a bit of discomfort to the patient and may need to be addressed.
Thank you. We have time for just one question, and this is a complicated one. I'll do my best to ask it. This person was misdiagnosed with MDS 20 years ago. They were diagnosed with PNH and von Willebrand's type 2 in 2000. They became symptomatic early in 2012 and started Soliris treatment in June of 2012 with blood transfusions. They were still transfusion dependent and was diagnosed with aplastic anemia in June of 2013. They had ATG treatment from July to August 4th, and they will start cyclosporine next week. Their cytogenetics show an aberration of trisomy 13 in 20 over 20 metaphases. What prognosis can they expect?
That is a complicated question, Cottrell. You know, trisomy 13 is, you know, not one of the things that's thought to be associated with a particularly poor prognosis, but certainly there's a clone there that will need to be monitored. I guess something I'm having a little bit of without, you know, having met the patient myself, if the Soliris treatment is ongoing and if the PNH is really causing an issue, or if it's just that the bone marrow failure from the PNH is causing a problem and it's still too early, I think after the ATG, if it was just given a few weeks ago to know, when was the ATG? It was in March?
It was July. It was recently July 30th, August 4th.
So it's quite a bit too early to comment on prognosis because it's only been a month. And you saw from those ATG data from the New England Journal study that about 62% of people respond at 3 months. And so let's see if you respond at 3 months, if you still have a big PNH clone and need to be treated with the Soliris, and then go from there.
Thank you so very much, Dr. DeZern, for your informative presentation and your time. And on behalf of the Aplastic Anemia MDS International Foundation, I would like to thank each of you for joining us today and making us your resource of choice for information on bone marrow failure diseases. If we were not able to answer your question today, please send it to us via email at help, H-E-L-P, at AAMDS.org. So that our patient educator can respond, or please visit our online learning center for interviews with experts and other programs that may address your question. As a reminder, as soon as I'm done speaking, a post-event survey will appear requesting your feedback. We appreciate your time taking the time to complete this survey. Again, thank you for joining us, and please remember, we are here to provide you with answers, support, and hope. This concludes today's program. Thank you.